Yeah, watch it. Got the riffs on the track. Set on the boys in church. Bishop Lamar. Wow. Yeah, the statistics shows my ballistic flows generate big cake, not big candles that spot yeah, tea them O's. I'm so ready, how them pack my clothes. I'm so heavy with no D, how them boys. I rock them gators more than good beat boys. I'm the real raw deal, y'all just steal decoys.
So, and yeah, it comes, it transformed from fiction into realism, even though it is work of fiction.
For that green like the footprint, no, not from New Orleans, but can you see me, homie? In oh, mic check, check 1, 2. If it ain't a check of text, that's all I'm gonna do. Mic check, check 1, 2. If you ain't talking dollars, I can't understand you. Mic check, check 1, 2. If it ain't a check of text, that's all I'm gonna do. Mic check. Check 1, 2. Yeah. If you ain't talking dollars, I can't understand you.
Yeah. Look around, left, right, up and down.
So in a time before everything starts, and the second book kind of gets into the very beginning of it, and then the third book kind of ends up the first phase of what happened.
My target audience when I wrote it in my head was the were basically teenage girls that had read Twilight and were sorry that it was over.
From the season. And they are in a mode from being a singer.
But, you know, you're the bus driver, right. You know? Yeah, there he is, you know. I like that. That's cool. It's like we're made for it.
Mic check, check 1, 2. If you ain't talking dollars, I can't understand you. Mic check, check 1, 2. If it ain't a check of text, that's all I'm gonna do. Mic check. Check 1, 2. If you ain't talking dollars, I can't.
Welcome to the great show of APN TV Media. We have a lot in store for you today. As a matter of fact, you know what? Today's topic is going to be very interesting. And somehow, are we going to actually say it or are we going to put it on the screen? I want a dark thriller, but it's a suspense thriller. The book is under fantasy. If you know about the genres now, the genres are more, look, I left the audience and going straight to them, huh? But it's for all of us. So we get an understanding on this. The genres, you got your basic genre, then you got the subgenre, and now you have like a sub-subgenre. And these new genres that's coming in, but you still have your basics. So we say it's under the fantasy, but at the same time, you got all these other genre categories like suspense, you know, or we could say that could be a subgenre because it's. I want to keep saying it's dark. The book is great, but it's dark.
I'm just glad it's fiction.
You're glad it's fiction.
I'm glad it's fiction.
I'm glad. We're all glad it's fiction. I bet the author's glad it's fiction. He's a writer. He's glad it's fiction. Okay, so we'll be knocking on the door here. Get your hands up. Nevertheless, I think today's topic, and I'm trying to get them to agree with me here. If they don't agree, they'll come up with one, and it's okay. You know what? It's by Eugene. Okay, H. Eugene, or say H. Eugene Wright. Okay, so the H period, E. U. G. E. N. E. So, and he's also, you'll see the website, it'll be shown on the screen, everything. The book is titled, and you'll see why we're tripping off this, okay? Because it's interesting, you know, if I was like Stan Lee, I'd be going to El Celsior. It's got that type of power for this type of genre. The book is titled Cereal No Milk. Now, cereal is spelled with capital S-E-R, that hyphenated, you know, that curly Q-A, I-L. I spelled that wrong, didn't I? It's S-E-R-I-A-L.
Yeah.
Did I do that right? Okay. Whew. Even though it's a poster, I better know this. But anyway, S-E-R-I hyphenated L. Because sometimes you'll probably miss the L if you look at it. You think it's cereal, but you look at it again, it's actually cereal. But the cereal in our what we look at, we'll automatically think cereal, like cereal, C-E-R-E-A-L.
Like,
but it's
the
S, and it's got a hyphenated.
Yes.
So anyway, the title is Cereal No Milk. Okay? And cereal is more or less, when the author gets up here, you know, on the set, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it had to do with, you know, serial killer, or killers, plural. But we're going to get into that, okay? Because this is, he left me off in a looper on the epilogue. There's an opening somewhere, but we're going to get to that too. Because I was like, is he going to make another one, or is that going to be the same one? Anyway, all that to bring us to this genre. The genre actually would be, I would think it would be dark, murder, suspense, thriller. Okay, that ties all in drama. Okay, now what do you think? That's too much for today's topic.
The book covers every aspect of that.
How do we do that? Can we go dark fantasy?
Keep it simple.
Well, yeah, it's in fantasy.
Yeah, well, yeah, dark fantasy.
Dark fantasy? There we go. Dark fantasy, there we go. Yeah,
I'm good.
Dark fantasy, and everybody like, did they just create a whole new topic? But then you see how it goes, because when you see movies today, they're now, even down to Batman, you know, even down to the superhero, all the superheroes and stuff, they're dark. I'm not saying the book's a superhero thing, no. What I'm trying to say is, even on regular family programs and stuff, there's a lot of things we watch that it's got more deeper. More, not just the HD, but deeper as far as dark creative writing.
Back in
but
the
it's
50s,
good.
It was the Twilight Zone.
Very
now
good.
Now you have Hannibal,
oh, yeah,
you have,
yeah,
Hannibal Lecter, you have Psycho, it's all changed.
Yes, yeah. Oh, we're going to talk about that, oh, Hannibal Lecter and that the Psycho thing, how they tie in, but we're going to have fun with that too. All right, but anyway, you have anything in post? Nothing, right? Okay, good enough. I tell you what, I'm going to bring H. Eugene up right after this.
Yeah, watch it. Got the riffs on the track. Dead on the boards. Church. Bishop Lamar. Wow. Yeah.
Welcome back. I know y'all was wondering, like, what is he talking about? I got a whole conversation on genre, but when do you look it up? When you look it up, or you go to any bookstore, or matter of fact, it's easy to go online, and you look under the book, you'll see there's genres, and then when you look for a certain book, or just type in the word book, and you see these genres, you're going to see genres that you have never, ever seen before. There's so many. And it does make it difficult to find the author and the book when there's so many genres, but you know, you try to give it an overall picture, so when you put that type of category, subcategory, subcategory together, then your meta tags, if anybody know what meta tags are, like for your search engines, it's easier to find it because now you have a whole bunch of them together that will actually, it's like a Rubik's Cube or a jigsaw puzzle, will come together and it'll spell out the book.
I'd recommend running to your junk drawer, grabbing a pen and a paper and writing it down because it's going to be on the bottom of the screen.
Yes.
Then you don't have to Google it.
Yes, very good. Very good. Either that or just go to our television website and you'll see it on there.
There you go. Yes. Right.
Okay, I'll watch the show on television here, so you'll still see it on there. Nevertheless. All right, let's get into it and you know what? Without further ado, let me bring out H. Eugene. Come on. Come on. Dude, you all got stuck in your book. In the beginning, you just got stuck in your book. So you know, oh, come on, everybody. Come on out here. I think you're interesting. There you go. Yes.
Look, I got family. Hello, friends. I am so enthused to be here today. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm really excited to talk about my book. And I think you probably have some questions that.
Oh yes.
Maybe lots of questions that I can answer.
Thank you.
I'm looking forward to it.
And no, I'm not gonna throw him under the bus on it because you know what? he's very talented, very gifted. He's got multiple books, and you know me, I love career authors because they mess with your mind because you're like, man, did he just come off of one genre and he went to the next one? And it's like he has that talent, that gift to exercise his creative writing. Okay, so I'm throwing that props out to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate that.
Wow. Yeah, the book, you know what? I'm going to start off even before she gets to it. Here's the book titled Cereal No Milk. And it is S-E-R-I, that hyphenated, if you want to call it A, okay, L, No Milk, okay? And he does have another book here, and I'm going to throw that out there. He does have another book.
Yes.
And it's The Ugly Bomb, or I'm not saying it right, am I?
It is, The Ugly Bomb.
But you have two, it's a trilogy, so you have two books.
This is, Cereal No Milk is the first book of a trilogy. The trilogy is titled The Broken Microphone. So, Cereal No Milk is book one, and The Ugly Bomb is book two. The third book was actually released a couple of weeks ago on ebook. Okay. The soft cover will be available.
That is beautiful.
Yes.
And the title of that?
The third book is called 13 Flowers, subtitle, Chocolate Will Kill You.
Chocolate Will Kill You. Oh, yes. Gonna upset a lot of women.
You want these titles. I don't know whether he's trying to make somebody hungry or scared to get to the dinner table. then we'll start off on this first one, and we'll go down the line on because
sure.
Wow, cereal. You know, cereal no milk. Matter of fact, these titles. Mm-hmm. How did you come up with these titles?
So the first title. With this first book, I knew that after writing, my very first book came out last July, called The Trifecta. And I knew that I wanted to do something a lot different. I wanted to do something about serial killers. I was always fascinated by horror movies when I was younger, and some of the characters in these horror movies, which kind of drove, you know, some of this fascination with serial killers, but I wanted to write something from a different perspective. I wanted to write it from a perspective of, you know, here's the serial killer and explaining why they do some of the things that they do, and you kind of learn a lot of backstory, which, you know, might make you feel a little sorry for the person in the book, but you learn from a different perspective as to how this person became who they are.
Just a question,
Angel. Yeah.
Did you research this before you, like serial killers, people that have committed these crimes or these abominations, did you research some of their story, their history come with that, or is it a creation?
That's the fun part of writing for me, because I like to do a lot of research.
Okay.
So I did a lot of research in terms of serial killers, pharmacology, because there's a use of some of that in the book. I've talked to several individuals in the entertainment industry, journalists, just to get some broad perspective on a few things that really helped as I was writing the book. As far as the title, I knew that I wanted it to be about a serial killer, and it just kind of came to me. So how can I make this creative? We've probably seen all sorts of titles with serial killer, and it just came to me about cereal milk. And it's like, cereal, no milk. And the no milk part you will understand as you get towards the end of the book, as far as the significance of milk and what that means.
Well, there was an FBI, the man who started FBI profiling is in the States for right now, wrote a number of books about serial killers and how they've learned to look at a crime scene and say, okay, this is what you're looking for in the killer. And it helps them, you know, track down the people who've committed crimes.
Yes.
Although sometimes they make a mistake. For instance, one time when an 80-year-old woman was raped by a man, they said, okay, only a teenager would do that. Well, the person turned out to be 30 years old, the man who did it, but he'd been in jail since he was 15, so mentally he was still a teenager, mentally and emotionally.
Yes.
So, you know, but it's good to understand that stuff because, for instance, they'll tell you people who know what serial killers are like or people who go after little kids will tell little kids, if you see anybody who scares you, an adult, get into a crowd of adults and he'll go away. Mm-hmm.
And, it, you know...
Wait a minute. Say that again?
Well, no. If a kid sees someone, an adult, who scares him, he thinks that adult's after him, he needs to get into an area where there are a bunch of adults and the guy who's after him will go away because these adults will see what he's doing or trying to do.
But mentally, he's not an adult.
No. If a kid's out someplace where a...
You're talking about the serial killer, right?
Serial killer or a rapist killer, whatever, is after him, and he gets to an area where there are a bunch of adults, that killer is not going to follow him because then all those adults will see him.
Oh. Makes him uncomfortable.
And he'll be identified.
No, I thought you had something hidden within that.
There was a tie.
Yeah, something that we both were scratching our heads about it.
Okay.
Because you mentioned about the mentality of a serial killer.
Right.
And it's ones that, you know, their mentality was as a youth, a kid.
Yes.
And if they were going after children, there are times that the, you know, I just want to get to the research on here, because the times that they go after a child, technically, there's some that may not actually go after the child unless a violent and volatile state presents itself, because they're introducing themselves to a child as a child going to the child.
Sure.
Like, hey, let's go play in the sandbox together. Mm-hmm. You got this grown man wants to play with some little kid in the sandbox, but the little kid probably say, oh, okay, because somehow the child is sensing a childlike mentality.
Right.
And then they go to play in the sandbox, and all of a sudden his mind flips on something that the child didn't like. The child threw sand on him, or, you know, playing around, and next you know it.
Triggers.
It triggers, thank you. It triggers, and now he becomes something else than that child.
Well, yeah. But you have certain people have, like, okay, a man who is a rapist. I brought that up. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, from what I've read, anytime a rapist goes to prison, he discovers he likes men better than he likes women. Okay.
This is getting dark.
So then where are we going?
So when he comes,
where are we going?
So then at that point, he might start looking at little boys, little girls, just, you know, the whole spectrum. Say all little boys or little girls see somebody weird looking at them, they just need to get towards a bunch of adults.
Let's get back to the book, Bob.
Yeah, okay.
Let's get back to the book.
You know what's funny is,
speaking of characters,
over here, but now you got back to cereal, no milk.
Yeah.
The child morality part out of that. And let's walk out the sandbox and
he does bring up a good point, because part of this book will take place when this person is quite young.
And wait a minute, you know what? We are going to go back to the sandbox.
Well, it gives you, so there are, it's all about conditioning. We're all conditioned. Usually, I think the outcome that we look for is positive reinforcement and conditioning from our parents. This is a person in the book that that didn't get that. It was the complete opposite of that. They were conditioned in a much different way and fashion, and because of how they were conditioned very early on, it led them down this path, and it tells that perspective. So you learn to appreciate how they became what they are, and ultimately, the way the book ends, you learn that this person had another purpose. So sometimes these people take on different personalities.
That's it.
You know what? Yeah, we are in the sandbox.
That's right.
You're right. No, you said it right. You broke it down. Whatever he's saying, you broke it down, and that's right. Well, the personality. The you know what? I'm sorry, because I'm the research that you did in your book. Now the research is because you have realism within the book.
Yes.
So to me, and I believe what we're looking at, because that we were saying, well, it's almost like you can't really sleep, or we got to keep reading because there was always something left that you have to find out.
Right.
Okay. A while ago, another show I called it a climax, and it reached a certain level of climax suspense. Okay, I do it that way, suspense, because you're curious now. What's going on? And that makes you first want to pick it up first thing in the morning. The only thing is you got cereal, no milk. So it's kind of, I stayed away from eating cereal. When I was reading that, I stayed away from eating cereal. I'm like, man, I can't believe this. This got me tripping over here. So, but nevertheless, it was a, in the book itself, okay, I don't know if I assume in the trilogy, did you, okay, how can I say it this way? Can a person say, like the detectives in them wanted to, and that's what relating to what you were saying, Michelle, was can a person actually utilize the book for another type of research purposes, just in case? Because you presented a level of the psychosis, so to speak, the psychoanalyzing a serial killer.
If you read the book, it's not beyond realism. It's something that could actually happen today. There, some of the research, for instance, there's a conversation between the journalist and a profiler, former profiler. And they're giving her some advice on techniques when you're talking to a person like this. These are things that you want to be guarded against, because there's only so much that you want to give them. There's a certain side that you want to show them, because they will quickly take advantage of you if you don't. So giving her...
What I'm doing is I'm exercising his books, what I'm doing, because I want the reader to know how deep it is in the book. Now, see... You just talked about the profiler, okay, and the examples that are shown in there. Are these examples, I'm not trying to throw you under the bus or nothing.
Oh, sure.
I know how strong this book can be, how powerful it can be, and I'm encouraging all of you to read his trilogy. In Cereal, No Milk, and I had to start off with that. It's because the profiler, okay, when you're giving the example, are these techniques, are they real?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
That then it can be used. That's what I wanted. You know what I'm saying? The techniques in the book for the profiling is real. So if it can be used as a, in other words, I can take this book and I can take it to a university or a school and have them read the book because, reason being, it has an educational documentary within the book itself. Even though it's like reading the Edgar Allan Poe book or, you know those mystery novels that they give out to classes. So I'm exercising more props for you.
Appreciate
okay?
That.
That the schools can actually pick up this book and hand it to their students and do questionnaires because it's more than just fantasy and it's more than just fiction because it has nonfiction characteristics that actually it becomes educational.
I would wait till the college level.
Uh-oh, because did it really scare you that bad?
I have not slept well for 5 days, and it never takes me that long to read a book. I had to pace myself.
Well, I tell you what, when I opened it up and I saw we all got into it. The pictures mm-hmm. in the beginning.
Yes.
What was that all about? That was interesting. Because you'll see in a moment, you'll see his video, okay, and then you'll understand it. That's why I was like, man, what is he doing? What is he doing to me? My mind was fixated, and that's what I wanted to know. Is this real or is it not real? I know it's not real, but it sounds like I'm watching a crime show.
That those pictures and even the mask, all of the words on the mask on the cover. It goes into that conditioning part that I was speaking about, how he was conditioned very early on.
Yeah, you know,
and that's an actual newspaper. Well, it's fiction, but it's supposed to be a newspaper. And again, conditioning. Mm-hmm. If you look at the newspaper, these are things that this person experienced.
We'll pop it up on the screen, but I don't want nobody to be alarmed. This is a fiction novel. Okay, but he has, well, see, it's interesting, his book, it always has something in here that you know, inspires you to read more, because out of curiosity, okay, he has, it's called The Daily Loser.
Yes.
And that's the magazine.
Yes.
But the magazine itself is so graphically and emotionally dark.
It is, on
and
on
it
purpose.
Was like, wow, I'm watching a NYPD Blue mixed in with what is those investigative besides NYPD
like
Blue?
Criminal Minds.
Thank you, Criminal Minds. Thank you. That's what I'm looking for. Criminal Minds. And this is it because it's
yeah. Well, you know
hey, you know, Bob.
Conditioning is a big factor in all with all those criminals. For instance. Charles Manson was taken away from his mother as a little child because she was a drug addict. He never met his father. He bounced from foster home to jail, and you know that was how he was raised. But
yes.
You know, a whole lot of the people in jail have names no one would ever want to have, like Onus or Odor. I mean, nasty names that their parents dropped on them. Mm-hmm. That tells you a lot about their upbringing.
Yeah.
I'm glad it took you a moment or two to grasp it. Yes, it's the serial killer. It created a novel. And I keep saying novel, I want to say the trilogy, but the novel. And I encourage you to get all three, because the third one will be coming out. It's one of those type of books that actually you can present it to a school. You know, and that's why I talk about the school, university, especially universities, that you can take a book like this and you can actually dissect it because of the nonfiction elements in a fiction book. Remember now, it's still fiction and it's still fantasy. But when you put the nonfiction, like the techniques, there's nothing wrong with that. It's just that the techniques bring it to life.
Yes.
So that when you're seeing this or on the news or something, or you're seeing this and you're watching a movie, it can relate, and it'll be identifiable. So that book will always, always, like timeless, will become identifiable, especially just the title itself, Cereal No Milk. So it draws attention. So
yeah, watch it. Got the words on the track. Set on the boys in church. This is my new roof. Wow. Yeah.
This trilogy, the trilogy was about a young journalist named Brooke Hanna, and Brooke Hanna is actually named after my twin daughters, mm-hmm. Brooke and Hanna. It tells a story of how she wanted to be a journalist for most of her life, and she ends up graduating from Michigan State and going to Florida. For her graduate program, and then she gets her dream job at this news station. And very early on, she gets, she interviews, mm-hmm. she goes to for this interview. She was actually requested by this person that's on death row. They want to interview with her, they want to tell her something. And after this interview, her life just spirals. And this is fiction, and some of it is over the top, but it's believable because it can happen. But it shows how someone that has no experience, they just became a journalist, and you're throwing all of these real life things at them, how she handles them. And it goes into the second book where, you know, the first book kind of brings her onto the scene, and she kind of becomes somewhat of a national name. By the second book, by the end of the second book, people know her internationally because of the things that that transpired during the second book. By the third book, mm-hmm. she's fighting for her life. And so it takes you through these seasons with the character. So you get to grow with her. You get to understand a lot of things that are going on with her head. There's a strong sense of family in these books, and you know, the things that she leans on and things that she believes in, really strong convictions. And I wrote her this way. She's a really strong character because this character is representative of my daughters. And I wanted them, when they grew up and when they read these, to say, hey, this is how mm-hmm. my dad looks at us. This is someone that they can be proud of, where they can say, hey, I'm Brooke Hanna in this book, and feel completely proud because of the type of character that she is.
Very good. Yes.
You know, this type of fiction that relates to real life mm-hmm. has been done in other areas as well. For instance, The Invisible Man by H.G. Wells
yes.
is only one of two books with that title. The other book, The Invisible Man, was written by a black man. His name doesn't come to me right now. But he called himself the Invisible Man because he didn't, in his opinion, a lot of people didn't see him. They just saw he was black, and they didn't see him as a person. So that was talking about real life yeah. in fiction, yeah. just the way your book is talking about real life in fiction, things Absolutely. That actually do happen, and people track them down, people write about them. You know, you got the detectives, the journalists, the whole group.
Yes.
That's all right. That's all right. You know what? I do have some questions I'm going to ask you on here.
And, sure.
Let's see. Oh, let's see what I got for you here.
Eugene, don't you have a poetry book coming out also?
Actually, it's out. The title of it is Speaking with My Lips Sealed, The Essence of Art and Love Through Poetry. And this book contains poems from very early on, like the mid-90s that I wrote, all the way up to early last year. And it covers a wide range of poems. They're not standard and standard poems in terms of size. They're longer poems. Some of them are abstract, some are motivational, and lots of love type poems. And
so it's not dark. It's a different side.
No,
of you.
It's
so there's
a
more
completely,
to Eugene.
Completely different side. Yes.
It's nice.
Yeah, I think there's something in that poetry book for everyone.
What influenced you to write this trilogy, the horror, the dark fiction?
Originally, I was going to write one book, and I wanted to write do something where I can incorporate my kids. I have three kids, a son and twin daughters, fraternal. And I said, you know what? Let's make this a trilogy. Let's make this a story that shows someone struggling, someone like them that they could relate to. This character goes through a lot of different changes that they've gone through. And I've also, there are many personal things that I put into these books that made them a little difficult to write. I can't really explain what they are, but from an emotional perspective, things that have happened to me. Not like the serial killer piece, but from the family perspective. And some of the things that Brooke goes through in these three books were based on personal experiences. And it was, you know, difficult to write some of these. You know, there are times where I had to just stop because the tears were flowing. So, yeah, these books are deeply personal. And I think you will, as you read through it, you'll get to really identify and bond with the character. That was my purpose.
How is your son written in?
In these three books, he's not. I'm actually doing, sometime next year, I'm going to be starting another trilogy where he's going to be like the lead.
Okay.
And he's really looking forward to that.
I did want to mention this because I thought that was admirable. Because you utilized your daughter's name, especially Brooke Hannah.
Yes.
Okay. Here it says, Cheryl No Milk introduces a new protagonist named Brooke Hannah. But this one key point that I love, read that over and over again, says, she is an investigative reporter with passion, pizzazz, and most importantly, integrity.
Mm-hmm.
And
yes,
that right there was important. It's like, you know, through her journey,
yes,
through the trilogy,
mm-hmm,
it's about integrity.
Yes.
And then when you said
never
it was more
it.
Personal, I was like, you know what? Some of you fine lined a point about his daughter with her structure having integrity. It's you know, growing, you know, when you train a child, and when they get old, you know, it's that point that you instilled in her, even in the book, it's about integrity.
Yeah, we all go through struggles, and
yeah,
there are some things that we sacrifice. You know, integrity is one of those things that you don't want to. You want to always maintain your integrity no matter what.
Very good.
And that's something that I've tried to instill in all my kids, and you know, with this character, it's just something that she'll be tested, but it's something she won't sacrifice.
Very good, very good. And on that note, you know what? We're going to go to our PSA. But you will see, actually, we're going to go and show the video on this PSA. Okay, so guess what? hold on to your seat belts, because this is going to be interesting. It will blow your mind. So anyway, we'll be right back after this.
Yeah, watch it. Got the riffs on the track. Set on the boards, church. This is Lamar. Wow. Yeah.
Nine-one-one. What's your emergency?
Yes, I want to report a murder. Oh, but wait, there's eight bodies, not just one. But I think Bartholomew's going to be upset with me. You know, perhaps I'll get some fresh air and wait on the porch. Tell the ambulance drivers I did my best to clean up.
Not all stories have to end this way. It's always how they began that causes the problem. Some parents are kind and loving. Their kids grow up in an environment of respect and encouragement. But some aren't.
I hate you. I wish I never had you. You are so damn stupid. You're a waste of life.
But one day, regardless of their upbringing, they all grow up and become something. Sometimes, they become deadly.
Welcome back, welcome back. Yes. Okay, that was interesting. And now you see why I was wondering, like, we were all saying, man, this is, it's, when we mentioned about disturbing, even during the PSAs and also on the national television that you know, you're aware of, that we have at the brokerage media, ASA brokerage media, it was about disturbing, but not disturbing into a negative way. It's disturbing as far as it's like watching a horror flick, you know, suspense thrillers. That's what I was getting, suspense thrillers. And with this trilogy, now I can't just say it's just one book. You have to read all three.
Yes.
Because when I was talking about the epilogue, and I'm going, and I start, and I says, serial killer. Then all of a sudden, my head says serial killers, and I'm going, "Yeah, what am I doing?" It's and wasn't even thinking. He's got because she investigates all these serial killers.
Well, it's not the serial killer aspect is just book one. Book two and book three are completely different stories. Yes.
Oh my gosh! See. Now, yes. You got me in a loophole here, and you know. So good. He encouraged me to keep reading. But nevertheless, I am glad to know that his book does carry that, and I encourage those not to be afraid to add. I mean, and ask, you know, your publishers or ask somebody, you know, and if not, you can always give us a call here or put it into APN TV Media about, you know, not just genres, about a nonfiction. Can you add nonfiction into your fiction? Because if you think about it, what makes movies great, what makes books great, is that you can be identified with nonfiction. Now, that's not saying just go out and just says, you know what, I saw something today and I'm going to write it in there. You'll probably get in trouble for libel and slander, okay? Or get in trouble if they thinking that you must you added something in there that they didn't know about. They accidentally found what you just wrote, and you said, no, so you don't want to get yourself in trouble. Actually, you want to be able to ask somebody about how to place nonfiction into a fiction book to give it that realization. Okay, yes. Am I saying that right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so let me go with this question here. This question I want to ask you is, what do you feel makes your book stand out from the crowd? Which is obvious now, but good.
Well, I look at it from the perspective of storytelling versus writing a book. So I want to, objective is to tell a story, an original story that's entertaining. There's some realism to it, but then there's this over-the-top element where you're like, whoa, what did I just read? And when you reach the end of the book, it gives you something to think about, you know, the next day or maybe a week later. You're thinking about what you read, and you might want to reread a couple of passages. But, you know, more importantly, it gives you an appetite to want to read the next thing that or the next project that I'm working on, because it's original and it's entertaining. It's something that's different than what you would typically read.
I will be thinking about this book for a long time. you nailed it.
Yeah. So your mom was asking, did they arrest this man?
Why are you It's fiction, Mom, it's fiction.
Very good. You did a great job on that book.
Thank you.
Well done. Well done.
You know, it reminds me a little bit. Patricia Cornwell is a well-known author, and she saw a painting in a London police station, and the man joked that was painted by Jack the Ripper, and she thought that looks like something Jack the Ripper would have painted. So she investigated, and she thinks she discovered who he was. Ooh. She wrote a book about it. And that thing, I had to put down for a while, because getting inside the head of someone who's as sick as Jack the Ripper was doesn't do anything good for your psyche.
You mean that she was trying to identify who he was inside, or who he was, period?
Who he was, period, but...
I thought he was the guy we went somewhere with this, but I'm talking about. I saw a documentary that they said it was the guy. Even Spock on Star Trek did a documentary on it. Leonard Nimoy.
Yeah.
This documentary had to do with the down Queen Elizabeth's family lineage.
Well, no.
He was royalty or something.
Yeah,
like
but
that.
No, she said it was Walter Sickert, who was an understudy of the famous painter Whistler's mother, and Degas. Lord of the Dance, and she provided great evidence that it was Walter Sickert.
And Walter Sickert is?
Walter Sickert, an author, an artist, an understudy of Whistler and Degas.
So now we're saying, it's a possibility that it's an artist then?
Yeah, well that's the title of her book is...
Now you see why serial killers, I mean it's hard getting a hold of them, because
right.
This psychological thing in their mind takes them somewhere, and you can't, it's like hunting down a ghost.
Yeah.
Because you got to really understand the mind of those that's somewhere else. You know, and then in that little diabolical, that's like a split personality that knows each other.
Yes.
You know, it's,
right.
You know, not beyond the Dr. Jekyll, no, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde knew each other.
They were the same person.
They were the same person, but they split, right?
Right.
Okay, but they knew each other's own mentality inside.
Right.
They knew about each other. And if they know about each other, which is still, you know, a really mental breakdown here, but they was able to cover each other's tracks.
Right.
You see how that goes?
Yep.
And serial killers, those are the most dangerous, is when they can, psychologically, it's able to diabolically cover its own tracks, and the other part of the person knows it, has to cover it, because the other person is like, look, I don't want to go to jail, but, you know, inside their head. But the other part is like, but they can't. It's like splitting yourself in half and saying, yeah, you're going to go to jail. But since it's you, you're not going to take yourself to jail.
I mean, it's a great illustration of how complex the mind can be.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. The only person I know who did that, you know, through all these experiences was everybody watching the one of the darkest shows around. It just came, the American Horror Story.
Oh yeah.
In American Horror Story, you had the one with the circus. Mm-hmm. And he killed the doll. He thought the doll was real. He was killing real people, but you won't see him going to jail. But then all of a sudden, he kills the doll that like supposedly made him do it or something like that. And then he turned himself in because he was in love with the doll. And he couldn't believe he killed the doll. So he carried the doll into the police station that was covered over. And he thought it was a real person, his lady, or whoever she is to him. And he says, I can't believe I killed her. I can't believe, you know, take me to the gas chamber or something like that, right? So he puts this little lady, or actually doll, but it was like a little lady, and he thinks she's real. After all this killing, it happens to be the doll that he freaks out on. But he's been protecting himself all this time. He sits her on the table, right? Still blanketed up, and they're going, sir, they're thinking, you know, it's a real person under this thing. So they're like, oh, shoot. You know, so they pulled the blanket over, and it was a doll. And he looks at the doll. Everybody looks at the doll like, this dude's psychotic. He didn't kill, but he did kill people, but to them, he didn't.
Right.
What I'm trying to get is that now he falls on the ground, goes, oh, he starts screaming, take me to the gas chamber. So he looks like a nutcake, you know, nutcase. And, you know, what's fun, what's interesting is that the psychology in his head, because that split personality, mm-hmm. it separated itself for that moment. But he is still in that psychosis. He is still in that. He is still a killer.
Yes.
That's the whole thing about him. And that's the one thing that's diabolical about those split personalities that protects each other, because it's almost like they have no choice mm-hmm. but to protect each other.
That's exactly a great representation of this book, I'd have to say.
Yeah. There you go. All right. We have a question. I'm going to throw another question at him. I know we're running out of time, but I got some more questions here. Okay. Let me do it.
Go ahead.
Okay. What advice would you give to other indie authors?
My advice would be to write your story. Don't worry about the marketing aspect or any of these other pieces. Write the story first. Take your time, write the story, and know that there are tons of resources, free resources out there yes. that will help you along the way.
Yes, and he's a great inspiration for other indie authors. Indie authors to know that. You are a great inspiration to them as well.
Yeah, and through my website, if I can help anyone, give any advice, feel free to reach out to me via website or any of my social media outlets. I'd gladly help anyone.
Excellent, awesome. Excellent. And you know what, one more.
I noticed that you wanted to write because you started doing poetry at a young age.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And you were rewarded for it, and it just consumed you that it made you want to start writing
yes.
stories and books. When were you first published?
And my first book, so I started writing my first book back about 9 years ago, almost 10 years ago. And I wrote a few pages and I sat it down for like a year. Picked it up again, wrote a little bit more, sat it down again, and I went through this cycle for quite some time until I said, you know what, this is a pretty decent story. Let's just finish this thing. And I sat down for about 7 months straight and finished a book. And I gave myself a goal of publishing this book.
Who influenced you to do that? Was it just inside, or?
Well, this story actually happened during, you know, The Trifecta was my first book. And I was going through a rough time in my life during that time with, there was divorce and there were some other things, and I was questioning my faith. And this book And again, it's fiction, and it's way over the top. But it talks about how a person, how this person has lost their faith, but they found out that they are the central character and helping to save everyone else's. So they find out that they are someone quite significant in human history. And this book tells the story of that, the trifecta.
I'm going to do it before we close out. And you mentioned faith, Christian?
Yes.
Christianity? Okay, and that's good because, see, the one thing I love about it is that you don't have to be stereotyped as a Christian that floats in the clouds to be able to say that since I'm a Christian, I am forced to write a Christianic book. Okay, that's robotic. Mm-hmm. That's not about gift and talents. The gift and talents is what God gives you. And he didn't say he wrote it out here to act the fool. He wrote a novel. He wrote a trilogy. And it does make people question about their faith. I know what you're talking about. I believe in all the books I've written. And the authors that I've met throughout over two, three, well, almost four decades since the time of my mother.
Jim, watch it. Got the whips on the track. Dead on the boys. Church. This is Lamarck. Wow. Yeah, the statistics shows my ballistic flows generate big cake. Not quick, can't those that spaghetti them O's. I'm so ready, how to pack my clothes. I'm so heavy with no D, how them boys. I rock them gators more than good beat boys. I'm the real raw deal, y'all just steal decoys. Like them duck hunters, runners, blowing whistles, making noise. It's official, tell them missiles, I'm the dizzle, flow sizzle. Shizzle, I'm off the hizzy, busy signal. Got that hustle muscle for that green light before break. No, not from New Orleans, but can you see me, homie, in O? Mic check, check 1, 2. If it ain't a check attached, that's all I'm gon' do. Mic check, check 1, 2. If you ain't talking dollars, I can't understand you. Mic check, check 1, 2. If it ain't a check attached, that's all I'm gon' do. Mic check, check 1, 2. Yeah. If you ain't talking dollars, I can't understand you.
Yeah. Look around, left, right, up and down. Ain't nobody like me. Wrist so icy, colors like iced tea. Them diamonds get pricey. Got rich now, everybody so nice to me. I'm a whiz kid, Doogie Howser. Just like the game, snatch your dame, I'm Bowser. Spit hot flames, stay sagging in my trousers. Even on church day, the preacher like no way. And Miss Jenkins like, Lord, take them demons away. In my headphones, Jesus walks by Kanye. Macking to a chickie, trying to get some kissy kissy. You can nibble on my neck, but no hickey. Mic check, check 1, 2. If it ain't a check attached, that's all I'm gon' do. Mic check, check 1, 2. If you ain't talking dollars, I can't understand you. Mic check, check 1, 2. If it ain't a check attached, that's all I'm gon' do. Mic check, check 1, 2. If you ain't talking dollars, I can't understand you. Baby, I'm the bomb diggy. Girls be begging for another chance like I'm Biggie. I run the city, call me P. Diddy. My life's Whoopi Goldberg, it ain't nothing pretty. It's been a long time coming, this ain't happen quickly. Overnight, try more, like, over and over into the morning light. Steady trying to get it right.